Praise the Lord. Can have the seats. Our God is a good God. There is no situation, no circumstance that can remove that fact. Hallelujah. Amen. Peter wrote to the church. He said, consider it not strange, the fiery trial which you are passing through. He said, for the same is being worked out amongst your brethren. Hallelujah. Consider it not strange, the fiery, it's a fiery trial that has come upon you. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Oh God, we give you praise. We give you praise. The reason why we don't give God enough praise in our life, the reason why our life does not speak of thanksgiving, praise, and gratitude unto God is because we are not able to see. Oh, we are not able to see what God has done for us. The problem is that we are short-sighted. Our present situation and circumstance succeeded to cloud our eyes from seeing God. Oh, that's why our life not reflect praise and thanksgiving and glory to God. We've not seen Him as we ought to see Him. I like us to pray this morning and say, Lord, open my eyes. I want to behold Jesus. I want to see Him. Lord, open my eyes. I want to see Jesus. I want to see Him. Oh, I want to see Him. The scripture says that God so loved the world. God so loved the world. God so loved you and I that He gave us of His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Oh. Jesus. God so loved the world that He gave us Jesus. Lord, open my eyes this morning that I will see this gift of yours. Lord, I need to see this gift. I need to behold this gift that you have given me out of your love for me. I want to know this gift. I want to understand this gift that you've given me. Lord, open my eyes this morning. I want to see Him. I want to behold Him. When Jesus appeared on the scene, John had been speaking concerning Him, of the one that is coming, who is mightier than He is. When Jesus came into the scene, He declared to the people, He said, repent, for the kingdom of God has arrived. That kingdom that you have been waiting for, that kingdom that you and I have been waiting for, He said, that kingdom has finally arrived. Oh, the kingdom has arrived. Jesus. And the children of Israel, they were glad, they were happy, they rejoiced that at last their salvation has come. At last their deliverance has come. Oh, finally, God was going to deliver them from the hands of the Romans. Oh. But Jesus said that was not the mission for which He came for. have come for something better. I have come for something better. I know that you are under bondage right now. I know that the Romans are oppressing you. I know what you're going through. I know your problems. I can identify with what you're going through. I know your problems. But I have something better for you. I have something better. Which I have brought for you. But that thing that I've brought for you, you can't see it with your physical eyes. If you're trying to see it the way you see things in the world that you're used to, you will never be able to see it. What I've brought for you is something greater. It's something better. Hallelujah. Till today, men are still struggling to understand that kingdom that Jesus Christ brought. Men have perverted the purpose of God deliberately. They have twisted the purpose of God. The one that brought the kingdom, when he brought the kingdom, he never said that this kingdom was of this world that we are talking about. He never paraded himself in any way as one that was speaking or living as far as this world was concerned. His lifestyle was completely that of the kingdom of God. Was never anything of this world. He was mindful of the will of God, that the purpose of God will be fulfilled in your life and in my life. He minded after the things of God. As I see my Father work, so I work. Whatever I see my Father do, so I also do. I've not come to do my own will, but I've come to do the will of him that sent me. Oh, the scripture recorded that the zeal for the kingdom of God, of his Father's house, had consumed him. Jesus knew where he was coming from. And he knew that where he's coming from is nowhere to be compared to what you and I have in this world. He knew where he was coming from. That's why men have also perverted the scripture. They will always tell you, that was Jesus. He wasn't looking after the things of the world. Why? Because he was God. And because he needed. He needed to do that for you and I, so that we can have all that we need in this world, so that we can be rich in this world. The scripture said, though he was rich, he became poor, that through his poverty, we all might become rich. So you see, he came minding after the things of God. He became poor for me, so that through his poverty, now I can be rich in the world. Is that not perversion? That's clear perversion. If Jesus was talking about being rich in the world, why did he tell the rich man to go and sell what he had? Why did he talk about life not consisting in the abundance of things a man possesses? And then talked about the rich man that wanted to expand his barn, how God had to call him home right away. And then talked of the rich man and Lazarus. If what he was talking about was our becoming rich, why all those stories and encounters? It wasn't about being rich. Praise the Lord. Though he was rich, where he was with God, he became poor. Coming into this world made him poor. I get in the point. This world is a poor place. This world is what? A poor place. Hallelujah. He became poor that by identifying with the poverty that you and I are in, we might become rich. I go to the Father to prepare a place for you. He said, I will come to take you, that where I am, you may be also. Hallelujah. That's what that scripture is saying. It's not talking about physical riches. It's not talking about wealth. He became rich. He that was rich took poverty. The problem is that we have not realized that this world is a poor place. Poor. Poor. What does the world have to offer you? Beautiful car. Beautiful house. What else? What else does it offer? That's right. No. What else? What else? Fame. After that, what else? The world, when you look at it, that's why the scripture talks of, you know, that you live soberly. When you are sober, you will understand that there is nothing in these things. That's how come Solomon, when his eyes opened, when he became sober, he said, all is what? Vanity. If you read the book of Proverbs, you will see that earlier on he was calling them blessing. How God will bless a righteous man and will give him silver and gold and long life and the rest of them. At the end of the day, he said in conclusion, it's vanity. What do you call blessing? What is blessing? What is blessing? Blessing is something that is general. Something that is profitable to everybody. That's what blessing is. Something that is profitable to everyone. That's what is blessing. Hallelujah. Tell me, what else in this world that you can say yes, that it qualifies to have that definition? Tell me, is it fine car? You call it blessing? When you encounter armed robbers with the car, it becomes a curse. Yeah? Or when you have accident with it, it becomes a curse. Which one is blessing? God bless me. Bless you with what? That's why Jesus talked about when you seek the kingdom and his righteousness, God will give you what you need, not blessing. God doesn't give you blessing. He gives you what you need. A might need homer deep. The same does not go for B. Are you following what I'm saying? Because homer deep for B will destroy him. Are you following what I'm saying? He gives you what you need. That's it. It's not blessing. How can blessing be what will destroy you? Cannot be. Some will pray, probably they don't have issues, and they pray, God, give me children. And the Bible tells us that children are that the blessings of the Lord. Ah. That's right. that blessing may eventually become an arm robber. Like that one newspaper headline I saw one time. One boy that killed his mother. They wrote, boy from hell. Boy from hell. When he was born, was he boy from hell? It was God. They probably did the highest thanksgiving. I mean, come up. Stop living in this world now. God is saying, come up. This place is a poor place. A place filled with poverty. Come up! Stop dwelling where you are. Come up. Come up. The problem with where you are is that it is not only a poor place. It is a place that will destroy you if you don't take time. Are you following what I'm saying? It's not just a poor place. It is also a place filled with debt. Come up! What are you doing in this world? What are you looking for? What are you looking for? What are you looking for in this world? Come up! Come up! What are you doing in this place that is filled with poverty and debt? There's one TV program we used to watch then. A detective program. It was called Chaos. Chaos. What you have here is what? Chaos. That's what you have here. When God looks at this world, what does he see? Chaos. An abuse. An abuse of his knowledge. Mind you, the knowledge of good and evil belongs to God. But this is not what he intended for it to be used for. Man has perverted it. That's why it is chaos. He said knowledge of good and evil does not belong. Are you the one that planted it in the Garden of Eden? You are the one? You are the one that planted it. It doesn't belong to God. You are the one that planted it. Thank you. It belongs to him. It's his knowledge. But it's not being used how he intended it to be used. Are you following what I'm saying? God has his plans. Man went and took of the knowledge that God never wanted him to take of, and perverted the purpose of God. Perverted the purpose of God. And you are busy asking for blessing. Know what you're asking for? Praise the Lord. Blessing is the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what is blessing. Oh Jesus, have mercy. 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 The enemy. You say the devil doesn't have any hold on you, but every day he takes advantage of you and you don't know. He plays on your intelligence every day. How does he play on your intelligence? The devil knows the weakness of man. What's the weakness of man? Man always appreciates what he sees. That's why men of faith do not walk by sight. If you are going to be a man of faith, you are going to walk by sight. He takes advantage of you every day because you have a weakness, and that weakness is that you always appreciate what you see. That's your weakness. You don't know. Oh, know it today. That's how come the devil is always having his way where you are, because you walk by what you see. You are guided by what you see. The world tells you this is the direction, and you follow suit. Why? Because that's what you can see. Because you have seen others moving in that direction and they are making it. You also want to go there in order to make it. That's your weakness. What you see. Why is it? Why are you not happy with God? Tell me. It's not as a consequence of what you are seeing. The reason why you are not joyful in the Lord is as a consequence of what you are seeing. Yeah, that's why you are not joyful. What are you seeing? You are seeing that A is driving Lexus and you are moving on Legedis Benz. That's your problem. A is living in a penthouse and you are living in a hut. And you are saying, how can it? If God loves me, how can it be that he will allow me to stay in this hut? How can he allow me to be moving on Legedis Benz when these thieves, when these robbers that I see them cruising in the world? that's how come the devil has gotten your attention, because he's working on what you can see. What are you seeing, my friends? They have all made it. You know, okay, now he's in US now. He's married, he has built a mansion that he's living in. Okay, hey. Ndi owoma. Ndi chukwu funaya. You know what's okay now? The worst thing that can happen to you is when you meet an old-time friend. Hey, Chineke. You know Chichoke? Don't you remember Chichoke? They just gave Chichoke just signed $1 billion contract the other day in Abuja. Hi, that day is spoiled for you. See naked. Hi, see naked. It's not from love can then allow from that true vine. Now that information, the Holy Spirit will walk around the clock another 7 days to correct your mindset. Chineke. The worst thing was that Chijoke was a loafer when you were in school. Chineke. God, what do I have to show? That for following you, for serving you, what do I have to show? There's no shamiluyah. Nothing to show that I'm serving you. Let's turn our Bibles to John, the book of John, chapter 18, verse 36. Jesus was answering to Pilate. The scripture said, Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence." Pilate therefore said unto him, "Art thou a king then?" Jesus answered, "Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. Praise the Lord. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. And my kingdom is not of this world. Has it come to your consciousness? Have you understood? Praise the Lord. Have you understood that your kingdom, the kingdom that God has given you, is not of this world? Because if you don't understand, you will be busy every day comparing yourself with the world. Because you don't know that your kingdom is not of this world. That's why you are busy every day comparing yourself with the world. There's one servant of God called Money. That servant is a perverted servant that will always want to establish himself as the master. If you are not careful, you begin to serve him. When God gives you money, he doesn't give you money so that you will begin to serve money. He gives money to you so that money will serve you, not for you to serve money. But money will not have any of it, though. No. He's a perverted servant. The moment he's able to sort one of your needs, you know the thing he will tell you? Can't you see? I am the one that is important. Am I not the one that sorted out your problem just now? Can't you see how I just cleared the way for you? Was he the one that cleared the way for you? He wasn't the one. It was God that gave you the money so that money will serve you. But money is now claiming that he's the one that cleared the way for you. Can't you see? I'm more important than this God that you are following. Can't you see? And like that, you know, I can do many things for you. That Hummer Jeep you want, I can give it to you. Just bow down and worship me. Just do my business. Forget this God that you are following. Just get down to this place right now, and I'll give you connection. Once you talk to that man, now he'll give you something to do. And you have me in abundance. And then you can have all the things that you have been desiring to have, you know, that have been running away from you. You say, Nana, wow. Money preaches, so he has his own gospel, his own message. Do you know the message? See you at the top. Be all you can be. Get all you. You know what money does? Now, let me tell you what money does. If you're not careful, you understand what I'm talking about. Money, one of the main things it does is that it encourages you. It makes you to have confidence in what you have because of its ability to take care and sort out your problems. It makes you have confidence in what you have. And then it also makes you again to have confidence in your ability. That's what it does. It builds your confidence in your ability. Can't you see? I mean, there's none of us here that can say now that there have not been times in his life that he or she has said, I know what to do. If I just do this, I'll get money now. Who is schooling you? He's telling you of your abilities. And it's true. Oh, no. You have ability, don't you know? When it comes to chasing after money, I don't think if that is what I set myself to do, I don't think I'll be lucky, no, in any way. I'm telling you the truth. I'll be there. I'm telling you, I'll be there, the topmost top. I'll be there. Make no mistake about it. The fact that you have ability, that you can make it, it's not, nobody is denying it. Even God doesn't deny it. When God came to those that were building the Tower of Babel, what did he tell them?
God was never, let me make it clear to you again, God is never in doubt of your abilities. Let me tell you, that's the truth. You have what it takes to go out there and make it. You don't know. You have everything it takes. That's the knowledge Adam took from the Garden of Eden. That's why God punished him. That's why God said, you are going to struggle, sweat. I know you are taking this knowledge, but for you to eat of this knowledge, you will sweat. I will make sure that you find it difficult. Not that he knows what Adam has taken. Are you following what I'm saying? So you have it. Nobody, don't kid yourself that you are helpless. You are not helpless. You have what it takes to make it in the world. Everything it takes. Better than those people that you are even looking at and thinking that they are somewhere. What has happened to you in the kingdom of God is you have simply submitted yourself to the ability of God. Just like Jesus. He said, whatever I see my Father do, that I will do. Whatever I see my Father work, the work I see him doing, that I will work. My will is to do the will of him that sent me. That's what has happened. You have simply submitted your abilities to his ability. No longer your ability. Are you following what I'm saying? You have submitted your abilities that right now, you will now be doing what? The will of God. No longer your own will. That's the difference. That's the difference in being in the kingdom of God and not being in the kingdom of God. But what money tries to do is to pervert that submission, as it were, that trust that you have in God. He wants to pervert it. He wants you to begin to trust in your ability, not the ability of God. And I'm announcing to you and making it clear to you, you have that ability. Don't be deceived. It's in you. So you understand that what you have simply done is that you told yourself, I don't have anything. What I have is God. Peter and John looked at the man that was lame. They said, silver and gold have I not, but what I have, I give unto you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Who is my ability? Who is my strength? Who is my confidence? Rise up and walk. The reason why you have not been seeing the kingdom of God in manifestation in your life is because you have simply gone ahead walking and struggling by your strength. When the strength of the kingdom is just there for you, you are busy trying to get it by your strength, but the strength of the kingdom is just there by you. All you need is your eyes to be open to understand the strength, the power, like Ephesians taught, the power that is towards us, which is like the power that raised up Jesus Christ from the dead, according to Ephesians chapter 1. It said the power towards us believers, which is like the same power which he used to raise Jesus Christ from the dead. Remember Peter, when he tried to fish by his strength, he was not able to get anything. But when he put himself inside the strength of the master said, launch into the deep. He said, we have been toiling all day. We are not able to get anything. He said, launch. And when they launched, they were not able to carry the fish. They had to beckon on their partners and friends to come. The hall was marked. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Why would you submit to the perverted message that money has employed his prophets, as it were, the messengers of light, all over the place. Why would you submit yourself to such when the kingdom of God is there to assist you? Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. Like I said earlier, the devil works on our weakness. That's what he works on. That's what he takes advantage of. What you can see. I like you to know. He said God is a spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God is a spirit. What does it mean that God is a spirit? God is a limitless being. He's a limitless being. God cannot be restricted by time or space. He is everywhere. Are you following what I'm saying? He said, they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. They must know who he is. They have to realize that they are serving a limitless God. Are you following what I'm saying? A limitless God. You must know that in the kingdom that God has given you, God has given you, put in your hand, a limitless life. A life that cannot be restricted. Why would you allow your circumstances and your situation to lie to you concerning the abilities of God? That your circumstance, that your situation is trying to tell you that if you don't do something about it, and suddenly you are afraid, suddenly you are anxious, and suddenly you begin to walk like man, you begin to walk by your own strength, you have forgotten that God is a spirit, and they that serve him must worship him in spirit and in truth. You must know that you are serving a limitless God. A God that can turn around situations and circumstances in an instant. In an instant. Nothing can restrict the power of God. The kingdom of God defies the laws of nature and science that don't mean a thing to the kingdom of God. Why have you allowed that situation or circumstance to begin to shift your focus away from the kingdom of God? Why has that circumstance, that situation lied to you about the abilities of God? And you are suddenly believing, you are suddenly accepting that the kingdom of God cannot come to your rescue. When you tap into the limitless strength of God, when you tap into the limitless power of God, that power will ensure. That power does not give you what you don't need. Are you following what I'm saying? That's where people miss it. It only gives you what you need. Are you following what I'm saying? It doesn't give you what you don't need. It doesn't give you what will destroy you. So if you are looking for what you don't need, the kingdom of God will not give it to you. It will only give you what you need. That's the problem. Men are busy looking for things. That has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. That's the problem. When it comes to your need, if it is a need, the kingdom of God will meet it. Are you following what I'm saying? It is nothing. It's nothing to the kingdom of God. It is not. I mean, how do we explain these things? It is nothing. It doesn't mean anything to God. It is the least of things for God to do. Are you following what I'm saying? It does not speak in any way of the power of God. The power of God is about the life that is infusing inside of us. That eternal life that is working out in us. It's not about the things of this world. The things of this world are nothing to him. They are nothing. They don't mean anything to him. What God takes glory in is the fact that his life is being worked out in you. That's what his power is working out. Don't get yourself stuck on the process. Many are busy celebrating the fact that God just sorted out their need, and suddenly they are lost. Suddenly they are lost because they are busy celebrating the fact that God, and he's stuck there. Yeah? He's stuck in the process. He's stuck there. He's stuck in the process. What you see God doing in this world doesn't mean anything. I'm telling you the truth. It is the least of things for God to do. Don't go priding yourself about the things, about the processes that is taking place in this world. It doesn't mean anything to God. It is a non-issue where God is concerned. It's a non-issue. The reason why God has put food on your table is not for you to be jumping up and shouting, "Oh, God is a faithful God." No. The reason why he has put food on your table is such that you will be able to mind the things of Christ, which is the greater purpose of God. It's not for you to be dancing, "Oh, the Lord is a faithful God. Oh, praise the Lord." What's that? The reason why he delivered you from that accident that will have taken your life, it's not for you to be jumping about how God has spared my life. And that's not why he spared you. He spared you so that you can take in the knowledge of his son. Don't stop there. That's where the devil wants you to stop, because that's all you can see. Don't stop in the process. Move up. Move up. The devil has blinded your eyes because you are busy looking at the process. You are busy looking at how God is sorting you out in this life. That's all you can see. God is good because everything is working out. That's God. That's God for you. That's the God that you know. That's the God that you can see. That God that makes things work for you. That God that does miracles for you. That God that gives you bread on the table to eat. God is much more than that. God is much more than the process. He's much more than the process. What he's talking about is his kingdom. Don't allow circumstances and situation to remove your focus away from God. God is a limitless being. That your situation, that your circumstance is nothing to him. It's nothing to him. I don't know how to explain this thing. It's nothing. It doesn't mean anything. It's nothing. It's nothing. There's nothing that can be given to you in this world that can be compared to anything that God has in stock for you in the kingdom of God. Nothing. If Solomon said that all these things are vanity, he had it all. He had it all. There is nothing that can be given to you in this world that can be compared to what God has in stock for you in eternity. Assuming you just got home now. Assuming you just got home now, and for real, your bank has just called you and said somebody just willed $100 million to you. How will you feel? Tell me the truth. You feel happy? Good. How will you feel? Yeah. You feel great. $900 million. Do you know what that will do for you? Do you know what $100 million will do for you in this world? My God, my God. Some My God. For 1 year, I'm not sure that person with that individual will not sleep for 1 year. Eh? What will be going on in his head? Only God knows. Are you following what I'm saying? Now you can appreciate what I'm talking about. Now God has given you what cannot be compared to that $100 million. That's the truth. What God has given you cannot be compared to that $100 million in any way. You see the problem of man. See why? You see how come the devil takes advantage of us? Because we are excited about only the things we can see. Are you following what I'm saying? What God has given you is worth much more than that. I mean, the $100 million cannot even become to it. And you are not even grateful. Your life does not speak of thanksgiving and gratitude to God. Because you are busy. Your eyes have been taken away. Your focus has been taken away. You can only see the process where you are presently. And you can see that things are not working out very well. And because of that, these things, man, if I can't see the one I can see now, am I sure that this one you are telling me that it, let me have it now. So that if I'm seeing this one, I cannot be sure of the one you are talking of. You know? It doesn't work that way. You must walk by faith. You must walk by faith. But the truth of the matter, is that even though you may not have that $100 million physically with you, the link, the relationship that you have with God is what more. I mean, there's no way you can even compare that $100 million to it. What am I trying to say? That for God to put that $100 million in your hands is just like this. But you don't know. Are you following what I'm saying? It's just like this. It's just like this. There is nothing in this world that is a big deal to God. But you don't know. That's the problem. You don't know. When Jesus needed to pay tax, all he needed was to tell Peter, go and get that fish, the first one. You will catch there. Just collect the coin inside and go and pay for me, pay for yourself. That's all he needed us at that time. Hallelujah. That's all he needed. I'm telling you the truth. He didn't tell Peter, he didn't tell him to go and do any business in order to make money to go and pay their tax. Mind you, he didn't tell him to go and sell anything or go and, he said, go there. Money is there. Go and take it. Are you following what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Follow what I'm saying. Whenever you're talking about money, people follow better. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Now, what I'm trying to tell you is simply because God wants to communicate to us from where he is. But the problem is that we are too much into this world that we find it difficult to appreciate what God is saying. So we are going to use natural things that we are used to so that we can be talking about God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We'll be talking about natural things so that people can appreciate God better. Mm-hmm. So you know how Peter went and got the money from the mouth of the fish. That's right. What I'm trying to let you know is that it's not an issue of God giving you money that you will kill you or destroy you. What I want you to know is that the money that you need to sort out your problems, to take care of your needs, is somewhere just there waiting for you. That's the truth. Is there. Mind, everything that Jesus needed here, Jesus was not eating air, he was eating food and being well looked after while he was on earth.
Are you following what I'm saying?
When he needed an ass, he just said to the disciples, go and get that ass there. When he needed where he was going to celebrate the Passover, he just said, go and tell the good man. He has already the things that you need, those physical things that you need, yeah, they are there. Are you following what I'm saying? But you don't know. Why? Because the enemy has confused you to believe that you need to kill yourself. You need to kill yourself in order to have that thing. Jesus didn't tell Peter, go and borrow money. Are you following what I'm saying? He didn't tell Peter, go and do this business so that you get this money. He didn't say, go and take. They didn't have anything to sell. So even if they wanted to sell anything, there is nothing they can sell. Are you following what I'm saying? But the money was somewhere. Where that fish collected that money? Do you think it was God that put that money inside the fish? Oh, see you. God doesn't have what to do again than to go and manufacture money and put inside the inside fish. No, the fish must have swallowed that money somewhere. Are you following what I'm saying? It must have swallowed maybe somewhere in Asia or Europe. He swallowed the money there. Eh? And God just directed it, carry it. By this time, next tomorrow, my son will need this money that you have inside. Just be going that side. Eh? You think God will do? God doesn't have what to do again now to go and manufacture money and put inside the fish? No. Likewise, hey, it's the money. When people talk about money, you understand. Uh-huh. Likewise, the money that you need is somewhere. Are you following what I'm saying? It's somewhere. When you mind the things of the kingdom of God, God will open your eyes. You will see that money where it is. You go and get it. That's how it works. You will see that money. That money is somewhere. Eh? Somebody will just call you. Say, I don't know. Well, just take this thing. Whatever it will do for you, let it do. You think it's 2 naira that the man said you should take. By the time you get home, you understand that it wasn't 2 naira that the man gave you. Hallelujah. That's the way God works. Don't allow money to lie to you, to make you to begin to trust in your abilities and your strength. Jesus said, let the dead bury their dead. Leave them. Continue preaching the gospel. He said, come, let's go. Let's go ahead and preach this gospel. Let's go ahead and preach this gospel. Let's go ahead and preach this gospel. Let the dead bury their dead. Praise the Lord. The point I'm making is that the kingdom of God recognizes your need, my need in this world. Be they physical, be they spiritual. God knows that you have need. And God is not going to leave you stranded. It is in the interest of God, mind you, it is in the interest of God to provide you what I call the enabling environment for you to be able to mind the things of Christ. Are you following what I'm saying? It is in the interest of God that such is the case for you. But how will God do such a thing for you when you are not even serious with his kingdom? Are you following what I'm saying? The commitment and the seriousness with which you take up the cause of the kingdom of God is what will also commit the kingdom of God to take your issues seriously. Are you following what I'm saying? That is what is going to cause the kingdom of God to follow up on your case.
You know, even in our justice system, they have, if you go to prison, there are more people awaiting trial in that place than even the people that have been condemned awaiting trial. When you are not serious with the affairs, business of the kingdom of God, they will put you in awaiting trial. Some people have stayed in awaiting trial 10 years old. They are still waiting to be tried. You are not serious. Are you following what I'm saying? You are not serious. They put you, this one, let's suspend his case for now. He's still working by his strength. Let him continue. Yeah? But the moment you take the business of the kingdom
and make it your business and take it up seriously and commit yourself to it,
your case will move from a waiting trial. Eh? We'll move from a waiting trial and say, this case, give it priority attention. Give this case priority attention, because you yourself, you have committed yourself to the business of the kingdom of God. That's how it works. It doesn't work the other way around. It will not be God sorting you out first, and then you will now be able to serve the kingdom of God. Some people keep telling me, don't you think, somebody was telling me, said, don't you think it would be wonderful for God to give us the money so that we have the money to be able to use it to, you know, and work for this kingdom of God, do the things, business. Don't you think he will be in a better position to use this money, you know, to do the of God than a situation where we are struggling all the time? God has already set his order and his priority. You don't know better than God. Your wisdom, as far as God is concerned, is foolishness unto him. And that wisdom of God, which you call foolishness, is his strength and his power. That's the way he works. You will not change the order of God. You will not change the course of God. God knows that you will use that money to serve him. He knows. But first of all, he wants to put you in the right frame of mind for you to have the right mindset to be able to use that money or whatever he's going to give you for his kingdom. It's not the other way around. There's no way it will work the other way around for God to give you the money first and then you begin to serve him. Praise the Lord. That's not the order of the kingdom. The kingdom says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything that you need shall be given unto you. That's the way it works. Praise the Lord. Can we stand on our feet? Amen.